Professor Jagdish Kumar, our Vice Chancellor, has kindly agreed to chair this session. I request the Vice Chancellor to present a memento to our guest speaker. Now I request Professor Choudhary to conduct the proceedings.
Friends, a very good afternoon to all of you and a warm welcome to Dr. Shiv Choudhary. You know, in whichever profession we may be, you may be a teacher, you may be a politician, you may be a lawyer or a doctor. Ultimately, while we are working for our own survival, there is also a bigger responsibility on each of our shoulders. That is to lead our life in such a manner that all of us live happily and in a peaceful manner. So, the principles by which we lead our life, which results in a society which is happy, peaceful, sustainable, they are same, irrespective of whether it is economics or environment or some other subject. So therefore, although this lecture is organized by CESP, I am very glad to see that a well-known cardiologist is amongst us to speak on a topic which sounds very interesting to me. It says conquering the invincible. You know, as a teacher, we often use analogies and metaphors to make things simpler to our students. And this I find to be a very interesting metaphor, conquering the invincible. And we are very eager to listen to Dr. Shiv Choudhary. I invite Dr. Shiv Choudhary to deliver. This is the 26th Krishna Bharadwaj Memorial Lecture.
Very good afternoon. What Professor Padipto said, let me concise about my profession. By profession, I am a plumber, carpenter and a cobbler put together. I just cut open bodies, change valve, repair valve, clean the block tubes and finally stitch the leather together. So that's the nutshell about me. And again, I'm very thankful to JNU administration, especially Professor Pradipto, for inviting me to deliver this talk. It's an honor and privilege to me. The talk will sound little bit odd when we think about the person in whose remembrance we are conducting this lecture. But if you see the life of Professor Krishna Bharadwaj, I would say she was a very courageous lady. Opting for economics in 1950s for a girl who is coming from a middle class family, from a semi-urban background, again, I'm using word 1950s, was really courageous because economics was not the subject of choice or profession for girls at that period of time. So really, she was a courageous lady. Today is her death anniversary. 8 March, she died because of brain tumor. And today we are celebrating or observing International Women's Day also. So I think there cannot be any better day to remember Professor Krishna Bharadwaj. And I personally salute that this courageous soul. Cardiac surgery per se is one of the youngest branch of surgery, only few decades old. Whereas other branches are, say, hundreds of years old. If we take abdominal surgery, surgery of the stomach, liver and all these things, you will find history goes back, say, a couple of hundred of years. But cardiac surgery is only a few decades old. And as such, hundreds of people have contributed in development of cardiac surgery, leading to the present form. But if you ask me, I would identify few people who showed exemplary courage to upbring or to for the development of this specialty. So those people who showed exemplary courage for development of this specialty, are the subject of my talk today. You will have to tolerate with my husky voice because I have got a very bad sore throat and flu. So some handicap there. So when we start, what's courage? That is the basic question. Whom do we call courageous? So the person whom I will be talking about, whom I would be talking about, were they really courageous? So we should know what is courage. A simple definition of courage can be lack of fear. If we ask most of the people, they will say that, okay, if you are not afraid, you are courageous. But is it true? And to emphasize on this point, I would show you two small video clips. Actually, the sound is not coming, so we will miss that part. But we can see that the tiger is fighting the lion ferociously, and there is no element of fear in this, as far as we can see the body language of the tiger. Another small clip, you see this. I will start with this. You see this dog, he is wagging his tail. We can clearly see that he is afraid, but he has the sense of duty, he has to protect the form, and he is performing his duty. Just by seeing these two video clips, if you ask anybody, the answer will be straightforward that who is more courageous or who is courageous. So in continuation of that, when I was preparing these slides, I asked my wife, who is sitting here, to name some person from history or mythology whom we can call courageous. So from Western mythology and history, she could think of two people. One was David, the shepherd boy who dared to fight with a giant like Goliath. And another was Joan of Arc, a teenage girl who fought for her country and lost her life. I was surprised to listen to that answer. So I just asked these people, Hannibal, Genghis Khan, Napoleon, that don't you consider them courageous? So answer was that they were brave. They were strategists. But they were not courageous in true sense. Maybe it would click to the nature, to the psyche also, that they were very brave. They were fearless. Strategist. They were not afraid to fight great battle. But that was not courage, because they were not afraid anything. So when it comes to define the courage, I will bring something from what Mark Twain has said. That courage is not merely absence of fear. It is the fighting against fear. Fear is there. There is imminent danger in front of you. But you are still fighting with that. So that is courage. And that definition is not complete. If we simply say that, okay, fighting against fear is courage, it's not a complete definition. So what else? Something beyond fighting against the fear. That part, Aristotle can tell us, that your action has to be for a larger good. It should serve some greater purpose. So you risk your life, you risk your welfare, and fight for larger good, welfare of the society, welfare of the other people, risking your own self, that is courage. So today's talk, I have identified few people who have risked their life and career for the development of this specialty, and because of whose work we are in the present position. For last quarter of century, I have not tell but anyone else than cardiac surgeons. All the time when I talk, it is a cardiac surgical platform. But don't be afraid. I will not bombard you with medical jargon. So bottom line will be the principle of HCF, that I will not go beyond the seventh class biology. So if we take HCF in terms of biological knowledge of all of the house, the seventh class biology will be common to everybody. So I will not go beyond seventh class biology. So that is the HCF for this whole audience. To simplify a certain thing, I will be using certain terms, so I am defining those terms. Cardiac is heart, pulmonary is lung, atrium is the receiving chamber of heart, ventricle is the pumping chamber of heart, artery, our arteries are the tubes which carry blood away from the heart to the body, veins are the tube which carry blood from the body to the heart. Pure blood, red blood or oxygen rich blood, all are synonym. Impure blood, blue blood, oxygen deficit blood, again synonym. When I say circulation, that means I am talking about the flow of blood in the body. So this is the basic terminology. This is just to make things simpler. This is the heart. It's a muscular pump situated behind our this breastbone and rib cage, and it's beating all the time. It has got two parts, right side, left side. The blood from the right side goes to the lung, the blood from the left side goes to the rest of the body. They are, the blood comes on the right side, impure blood or black blood, venous blood, and it goes to the lung. This is pulmonary artery. This artery takes the blood from the heart to the lungs, where it is oxygenated, and then it comes to the left side of the heart. You see this in this one now. This blood is going through the pulmonary artery to the lung, and it will be coming back. This left side, it has come, the left side of the heart. It has pumped blood into the arteries. It has gone to the whole of the body. Then from there, there are anastomotic channels, which we call capillaries, and come back through the veins to the heart. When I talk about the functioning and structure of the heart in present day, it looks so simple. But that was not scenario. Till about 1700 years, we believed in something which was totally opposite to it. Now everything looks very simple. If you ask a primary school student also, he will be able to tell you about the working of the heart. But that thing was not true. This photograph is a photograph of Galen, the greatest physician ever heard. He was a Roman physician in 2nd century AD. And whatever Galen said got the seal of approval of church. So for approximately 16 centuries, whatever Galen said and 2nd century remained sacrosanct and gospel truth. If he would have said that if you drop a coin, it would travel upward, people will believe that. Luckily, he didn't say that. But for 1500 to 1600 years, Galen's hypothetical description of the body, because in that era, the dissection of animal and human body was not permitted. He was in Rome and dissection was not permitted. So it was just a gesticulation, a guesswork. Whatever he thought, he just put into text, and that became the truth. So much so that anybody who dared to speak opposite to what Galen has said was considered blasphemy, and people were put to death. And the latest example was Michael Servetus. He was put to death because he talked something which was not in confirmation with Galen's teaching. In 1556, he was burnt alive with the charges of blasphemy because he talked, he just contradicted Galen's teaching. So you can understand what had happened. 1500 years we believed what Galen said. And what Galen said, Galen and church put together, because both were more or less synonym. One thing, heart is the soul, the seat of spirituality and soul. It is the seat of passion. Heart sees everything, heart understands everything, and heart remembers everything. Heart is just like our flight data recorder, what everybody must be knowing about, black box, which records all the data of the flight. So heart records all the event and all of your deeds and thoughts. And at the day of judgment, when you are facing the Almighty, you go with your heart in your hand and produce there. And your fate will be decided by color of your heart. If it's golden, you go to heaven. If not, you go the other way. So that was the thought process. And hence, the tempering with the heart was not allowed, because it is a divine organ to serve a specific purpose. Besides that, that was the theological part of it, but something more to it. Galen came out that the liver is the center organ of the body. Liver, all of us know, is a large fleshy organ situated just under our right side of the rib cage in the upper part of the abdomen. So he said that it is the central organ of the body. Whatever we eat in the stomach, its juices are taken by liver, and the natural spirit mixes with the juices and is converted into blue blood. So see how the things are going. And this blue blood is pushed by the liver into the big venous channels, blue channels, and that remains there and just moves to and fro. It remains there. Each organ of the body is attracted towards these blue channels, which carry this blue blood and extract its share of nutrients from that. Okay? So that was one understanding of Galen. It didn't end here. What else? He said that some part of this blue blood goes to the heart, right side of the heart. We have seen that the venous blood goes to the right side of the heart. He said that some part of the blood goes to the right side of the heart and through invisible pores. Now see the imagination. First imagination was that the liver makes blood, the idea of natural spirit. Now assumption again, it's assumption because there was no proof, that some part of the blood is going across the heart from right side to left side through some pores which you cannot see. On the left side of the heart, again some assumption, the vital spirit mixes with the blue blood. And air, which they call pneumo, he was partially correct on this side, comes from the lung to the heart and mixes here in the blood. Because of this thing, the blood turns red and it starts boiling because of presence of the vital spirit. This red blood is distributed through the arterial circuit to the rest of the body to get evaporated in all other organs or excreted. So now we can see what we have learned just few seconds back, how different was the idea with which medicine the patient were treated and the idea of cardiac functioning was understood. And nobody dared, because if you dare, the stakes are there to be burnt alive. Here comes William Harvey. William Harvey, he was born in 1578. He did his medical schooling from Cambridge. He was an English person. And then went to Padua. Padua is the oldest university in the Europe. If we forget about the Greek institution and our Indian institution, oldest university or alive, still alive, is the Padua University. So there, though it was quite close to Vatican, but still because of the Venetian influence, Padua was more liberal than any other part of the world. Human dissection was permitted, but human dissection was limited to the bodies of convicts who were sentenced to death. And there were not many bodies and not many people to carry out dissection. But he learned, and just for reference, Galileo also belonged to Padua. So Padua was more logical thinking university ahead of its time. So in Padua, William Harvey learned two things. That the best thing to follow is your visual evidence, what you see, and secondly, what you can do through experiment. No rationalism, no divine intervention, no godly intervention. If you see something, you believe in it, or you can prove with some experiment. So that was William Harvey's training in Padua. Once he completed his training there, he came back to London and then he joined a hospital, St. Bartholomew. But this, I just mentioned, he joined the hospital there. Again, in England at that time, human dissection was banned. It was not permitted, not even the convicts. But he had a great passion for the structure of the human body. So what he did, he started visiting the graveyards and he would dig and rob the grave, freshly prepared grave, take out the body and will take it to his home and then carry out dissection. He was caught and he was sentenced to death. But luckily, his father-in-law was in the royal court. He used his influence and he was released. But his passion continued. He didn't give up. Even though he was sentenced to death once, he didn't give up. For his luck, his father died. I would say luck. Because according to prevailing law in England, the family had the right on the body. They could have done anything on the body. So Galileo was the natural heir of his father. So he decided to carry out dissection on his father's body. So this gave him some reputation to his passion and courage that doing it. Furthermore, in short while after death of his father, his sister also died. And she made a will that William Harvey should do dissection. Considering his passion, she just gifted her own body to William Harvey, and then one more relative. So his family supported him in this passion. At that very time when the things were going, he was inducted in the royal court, and then a patient came across who has sustained trauma to the chest couple of years back, and because of this trauma, a part of the chest wall was missing. This we do nowadays in some condition, we do surgically, but it happened in his case naturally. A part of the chest wall was missing, and through that you can just peep inside what's happening in the chest. So as a curiosity, he put his fingers inside this wound and he could feel that this something is pulsating, and immediately he could make out, because he was simultaneously was carrying out experiments and vivisection, dissecting the live animals. So he could make out that this is the heart of the person, what he was touching. So, and he touched it repeatedly, the person didn't feel anything. So he could deduce safely that yes, you can touch the heart and heart doesn't feel anything when you touch it. To prove his point, he took this patient to Charles I, who was the king of England at that time, and he made king to put his hand inside and touch the heart, and the king was convinced. And that was a great blow to Christianity, that the heart is not able to sense anything. So with these oppositions and everything, he was continuing. He was inducted as fellow of the Royal College of Physicians. That was the only body of all type of doctors there in England. And whatever they said in the matter of medicine, that was the final. So he did all his work. He did several experiments. And he was able to make it out that what Galen said was not correct. How could he reach to this conclusion? For example, just one thing I am just telling you. He made a small puncture in the great artery of a dog. The artery, which great artery means aorta, which carries blood from the heart to the rest of the body. And he collected the blood which was coming out with each beat. So each beat was ejecting about 20-25 ml of the blood. And the heart was beating say 50 to 60 times in each minute. So he calculated that every, in each hour, the heart is ejecting about 200 liters of blood. That means in one day, the heart will be ejecting about 2000 liters of blood. If liver is making that much of blood, which is a converted juice from the stomach, that means actually you should consume 2000 liters of fluid. That only will go to the liver to make 2000 liters of blue blood. So he said, no, there is something wrong. What Galen said was not correct. The same blood must be circulating again and again. So with experiment and logic, and he also said that, look, human body is a machine. And all the principles of physics apply to it. There is nothing divine or godly or spiritual in it. It's basically a machine and it should follow the rules of physics. So whenever he did an experiment, he tried to explain on the basis of the law of physics. So this is a famous photograph. Any medical book will say that when we see the vein on this side, if you empty the vein on one direction, you will be able to empty the vein in one direction. If you do it opposite, for example, if I empty my vein from this to this side, veins are those bluish, blue colored streaks on your limbs, you will be able to see. So if you do from periphery towards heart, you will be able to empty it. But if you do in opposite side, you won't be able to do it. So he could establish that blood moves in one direction. And with that 2000 liter principle, he said that it is circulating. So he could establish that blood is circulating in one direction and it is doing again and again. So with this he deduced that blood is running in circuit. And that was a great challenge to what Galen told. He tried to convince his colleagues in the Royal College of Physicians, but they were under such a heavy Galenic influence that nobody agreed to what Harvey was telling. They feared that all their medical practice was based on Galenic principles. So if they accept one of Galen's, criticism, if they accept one of Harvey's principle against Galen, whole of their practice will collapse. So nobody was ready what Harvey had to say. And just to prove, and by that time they came to know that Harvey had prepared his manuscript and he is ready for his publication. So just to prevent his publication, they brought certain statutory changes in the constitution of Royal College of Physicians and they empowered each and every other fellow of Royal College of Physicians for censorship. So the idea of censorship is quite old, you can see. That means if I am a fellow and I don't agree with his idea, I can censor his work. So that made it impossible for Harvey to publish his work in England. So he tried to get it published from somewhere else. And this book, which rather changed the world in terms of cardiovascular anatomy and physiology, came out in 1628 from Frankfurt. The England did not allow that book to be published. And what was the reaction? Immediately, as soon as he published the book, whole of the medical fraternity of England was after him. All of his colleagues were after him. All his peers were after him. And they declared that he is in collusion with Satan, he has been possessed, and he is not worthy of medical practice. So he continued to face this opposition, and there was element of political turmoil also, and ultimately he was declared a delinquent and was banished from London and was heavy penalty in terms of financial was put on him, and he was not allowed to come to the distance of 20 miles from London. He died as a very dissatisfied person, though he subsequently his work was recognized. But by the time when recognition came, it was too late. What Harvey did was revolutionary in his time, but the people didn't accept it as such. Gradually people started accepting the idea of Harvey, and there was more and more recognition to his work. But still, as late as 19th century, end of 19th century, people used to consider that heart surgery is the end of surgery. It's a dead end. You cannot do anything for the heart. And the people like Dr. Billroth is a great name in surgery. If anybody, you ask a medical student, he can swear in his by his name. So he said that if you try to operate on heart, this I'm telling 1891, he is telling that if you try to operate on heart, you will lose respect of your colleagues. So that was the scenario when people thought about it, that it is the limit, full stop, don't go beyond. But why it was so? There must be all those people who talked about it, maybe some emotional content, but there must be some rationale behind also. So let's see, why did they say that, okay, stop, you cannot operate on heart. Why was it? I can simply say that heart is a balloon or a bladder of rubber filled with blood, just like this bottle filled with colored water or blood. If I drop a coin in it, can we see that coin? No. So to see that coin, what needs to be done? We will have to empty this bottle. So that means to operate or to see inside the heart, we will have to throw whole of the blood out of the heart. This was one thing, one prerequisite. Secondly, you are jogging, and if you are asked to take notes, can you do it? Can you take notes while you are cycling, jogging, running? I don't think anybody can do it. So to take notes, you will have to stop. And as we have seen, you put your hand here, you will feel the heartbeat. Heart is beating all the time, round the clock. So to do something on the heart, you will have to stop the heart. So there are two prerequisites if you want to operate on the heart. One thing, stop the heart. And secondly, take out all the blood. Okay? So this is what? Everybody is familiar with this scenario at your home or in your office, and we all recognize this is what? UPS. Just a battery backup. An uninterrupted battery backup. Just like our computer system, our organs, all our organs have got an inbuilt UPS. The difference is that UPS of individual organ, the strength is different. For kidney, it may serve the purpose for half an hour. For the limb muscles, it may serve purpose for 6 hours, something like that. But brain is very notorious. The brain UPS works only for 5 minutes. That means if the blood supply to the brain goes away, for 5 minutes, brain will be dead. So if we are planning to stop heart and not maintaining the circulation, flow of the blood to the brain and other organs, what will happen? The brain will die. And brain death means death of the person. So that was not possible. That we cannot simply stop the heart and drain out whole of the blood for more than 5 minutes. That means if we plan to stop the heart and drain out the blood, we have to do for less than 5 minutes. People tried, but the results were horrendous. They couldn't make it. So something else needs to be done. And then the story unfolds from 1930. In October 1930, an elderly lady who had undergone gallbladder surgery in Howard, Massachusetts General Hospital, the clot from her legs went into her heart. This is our anatomy lesson. We have seen that the right side of the heart pumps blood in the pulmonary artery, which takes impure blood to the lungs. So in her case, a large clot which came from the leg and just lodged in the pulmonary artery. Now no more blood was going from the heart to the lungs. If blood is not going to the lungs, what will happen? The blood is not getting oxygenated. The gas exchange which takes at the lung is gone. So this patient died in front of this young medical intern whose name was John Gibbon. He saw that the lady was succumbing slowly and slowly, and finally, when her heart stopped, they opened the chest, because at that time they were not capable of operating on a beating heart. So when heart stopped, they opened her chest, the pulmonary artery, and then extracted the clot, but the patient didn't make it. So this started haunting this young man, and he thought maybe some alternative could be there. Again, he started thinking in terms of physics, that what purpose heart and lungs serve. He came out with the idea that heart is a pump. So if we substitute the function of the heart with a pump, that should work. And at the same time, the lungs serve as the purpose of a gas exchanger. That means it adds oxygen to the blood and it removes carbon dioxide from the blood. So it's a gas exchanger, plain and simple. So if you put something in such a way that the function of the heart and lung is substituted by an artificial circuit, what he said, cardiopulmonary bypass. Cardio stands for heart, pulmonary stands for lung. So if we bypass, what he thought, that if we take this venous blood or oxygen poor or deoxygenated blood from the right side of the heart and put through a gas exchanger where it is oxygenated and then pump it back into the circulation. If we are able to achieve that, we can stop the heart and lung pump. That was a revolutionary idea at that time, but he started working on it. So he was there at Howard for a short time period. He came back to Philadelphia for his practice, but this idea never left. He was not interested in practice. This idea of developing cardiopulmonary bypass haunted him. He just talked to the boss there in Howard again, Dr. Edward Churchill, and asked for his research fellowship. And reluctantly, Dr. Edward Churchill agreed. In 1933, he came back to Howard again and started experimenting. But because we may think that America provides a lot of grants to people and something, it's not in all the field and at all the time. Dr. Gibbon was not provided any grant because that was not their priority. The hospital didn't want to conduct any such research. So he didn't have any staff, he didn't have any space. So whatever he had to do himself. He was not an engineering student, but he was making tools for his purpose. He was making pump for whatever he wanted to do. So everything he was doing his own. The funds were limited, and there was no encouragement. As much as that Dr. Griffith, who was head of the medicine and his father's friend, he discouraged him that you are putting your career at risk. You have taken a project which is too big and the outcome is doubtful. You won't be able to publish any paper. Why don't you just take some smaller project where you will be able to submit your report quickly and the result, and you will have at least one or two publications in your name which will help you for an academic career. The same what we have now, the publisher of Paris, that thought used to continue in that time also. But Gibbon had passion for this. He just persisted. He said that no fund, okay. He started working on cats, and cats were expensive. So what he and his wife would do in the evening, they would just stroll in the streets of the Boston with some fish and a net and a sack in their hand, and will try to catch cats and will bring for experiment. So this was one part. Then he was not provided with any assistant to work in the lab. His wife volunteered that, okay, don't worry, I will do the work of the lab assistant. So this is how John Gibbon's work started. So we have seen that when he thought about cardiopulmonary bypass, two components were required. One was a pump, another was an oxygenator, and third component was a circuit to connect everything. Everything was artificial. So when he started experiment, the first hurdle came that as soon as the blood comes out of body and comes in contact with the artificial surface, it clots. You must have seen whenever the blood is taken in the syringe or it comes out, it clots after some time. So that was a great hurdle. What medicine we have now was not available at that time. So what can be done? The solution was that you take out all the blood of the animal in a vessel, beat with a rubber brush and remove and then filter it. So this will remove all the clotting factor which were present in the blood. But that was not the solution, because if you do all these things, what happens when you transfuse the same blood back to animal? Number one, their heart beat become irregular. Heart didn't like this, because certain changes happened by this process which were harmful to heart. And secondly, very soon they noticed that the kidneys are also not liking it, because as soon as you start perfusing the animal with that blood, blood components started appearing in the urine. That means you have done something very harmful to the blood, which is not compatible with the life. So something more was required. It looked like the destiny was working with working for Dr. Gibbon. In 1915, this is the picture of a medical student, J. McLean. He came from San Francisco to join the medical course in John Hopkins. But he was a poor boy and he wanted some assistance. So he started working in the lab of Dr. Howell, William Howell. He was a physiologist. So he was earning some money by working in his lab. This was the time period of World War I, and Dr. William Howell was trying to find out something which can promote blood clotting. You must remember the war is the major cause of progress of humankind. So they were also working for something which was helpful in war, because war injuries, the major cause of death was the wounds and bleeding. So William Howell was working for something which would stop bleeding. And J. McLean started working on it. But to his bad luck, he found something which doesn't allow blood to coagulate. So he started to find white. In contrast, he found black. And when he reported his result to Dr. William Howell, he just threw that is finding into dustbin, that my need is a factor which can promote clotting and you are bringing something which I don't need. But the good thing was that they published it. That is a difference between our society and the Western society. They published their failures also. So they published it. And that report was noticed by Dr. Charles Best in Toronto. He is the physiologist, and people associated with biological sciences remember him for the person who discovered insulin. So when he noticed this report, he started working on it. And this product was known as, was named as heparin. Heparin means derived from the liver. They started with liver, and so this came out. The first drug which prevented blood from clotting came out. So heparin was discovered. So it served a great purpose to Dr. Gibbon. So he had a drug in his hand that if at the initiation of your experiment, if you inject that drug to the cat, the blood will not clot even if you run in artificial circuit. Great discovery, great solution for him. Now, in due course of the time, he found that, okay, you have injected, but how long would it persist in the body? You cannot reverse it. No antidote of heparin was available, because heparin itself was recently discovered. So people never knew what's the antidote. So once you have given heparin to your cat, there only one outcome was there, that cat will finally die of bleeding. That was the ultimate outcome. So again, luck favored him. This is another psychophysiologist from New York University. He was working on prolonging the duration of action of these hormones. For example, he worked on insulin and he combined it with a compound extracted from sperms of whale that called protamine. So he combined insulin with protamine and he found that the action of duration or effectivity of insulin can be prolonged. Or from 2 hours, you can have 24 hours. So he started working with heparin also. And to his surprise, he found that if you combine heparin with protamine, the effect of the protamine, effect of the heparin is totally gone. So antidote of heparin was discovered. So now we have heparin with which you can just make the blood liquid, prevent clotting, and at the same time, when you want to reverse the effect of heparin, you give protamine and the heparin is gone. So with this, Dr. Gibbon progressed. 34 ended, his research assignment ended at Harvard. He came back to Philadelphia. He started working in Jefferson Medical College. This now the two things he was concentrating, one was the pump, another was oxygenator. This was the pump available at that time. It was a very crude pump. So he started with it, but the drawback with this pump was that you cannot regulate the flow with this pump. So it was unpredictable type of pump. And second thing, when you run the blood through this pump, the blood components get destroyed. So this was not a good pump. Very, one good thing about Dr. Gibbon was that he never wanted to keep his research as a secret. It was an open house. He never wanted to have any benefit out of his research. So it was open house for everybody. So people used to visit his lab very often. So this Hollywood look star, can anybody identify it? So he is not Hollywood star, he is Dr. Michael DeBakey. Michael DeBakey is one of the greatest name in cardiac surgery, and last time his name, he must have operated more than 500 head of states.